¿Están listos para nuestro segundo magistral del día? No, no están como muy animados. A ver, otra vez, por favor. ¡Eso! Venga, un aplauso, por favor, para Abraham Templeton.
Oh, you introduced me already. See, he was distracting me. Whoa! All right. Ooh, buenas noches, Jalisco. Eso es todo mi español. I am here to speak to you in English, I'm afraid, but about a revolution that's coming in transportation as it goes digital, as computers and cars get married. I call it robocars. There are many different names. But before I begin, I'm actually going to go back in time, and I'm going to tell you a little bit of internet history. And there we go. The internet took over the world. It was the exponential revolution that you've all seen and lived. And I want to tell you what its ingredients were, because I see them in other technologies. So what makes an exponential revolution? Well, the first thing is the presence of early adopters. Ah, dear, we have a technology problem going on here. Technology problem. All right. Early adopters are basically stupid people with too much money, right? They go out, they buy the 6S Plus of something, they still have a contract on their 6 Plus, but they're not stupid. They want to be on the cutting edge, and they provide innovation fuel to get things going. Another important element, which everyone here knows, is the presence of open and hackable platforms. Because in every company, no matter how good it is, if it's Google or Facebook, most of the smart people in the world work for someone else. And only when you tap the resources of the whole world can you actually build the things that change the world. Oh dear, we've got to get a better antenna on this. Another concept, and this is the important one where it's going to come back to, is an idea called the stupid network. I don't know if any of you have heard this. It was named after a phone company project in the 1980s they called the Intelligent Network. And the idea of the Intelligent Network was they built a whole new series of phone switches, and they had all sorts of new features, call waiting, call forwarding. These were new in those days. You could call up the phone company, and you could ask for them, and they gave them to you on the phone you already had on your desk. And for the younger people in the audience, I'll explain. People used to have phones on their desks with wires coming out of them, and people made phone calls on them. You'll see them in the museums. But the important thing was that the intelligence was in the network, not in the phone. The internet flipped that upside down. In the internet, they said, let's put the intelligence at the edges, in the phone, in the laptop, in the tablet, in the web server. And when we did that, anyone could innovate. Anyone could change things, because there was no one who could tell you no. The center of the network was stupid. It was simple. And everything smart about the internet is in your device. This remarkably allowed people to build things without getting permission from anybody. The guys who built Skype, you've all used Skype, right? Right? The number one provider of long-distance minutes in the world today. When those guys built that, they could not have gone to the phone companies and said, excuse me, phone companies, could we use your data lines to eat your lunch? Because the phone companies would have said no, but they had no power to. There was no one there. This brought us, again, the revolutions of the internet. So another important thing was the understanding that everything is becoming based on software. The value of every company in the world needs to be based on software. This is Marc Andreessen, who you may know as a VC and the man who worked on the Netscape browser, who said this in an essay recently, that software was eating the world. Well, I'm going to go further and say that if your project, your business, does not have its value in the software, then it will not survive in the 21st century. And here is why. You do not have a crystal ball. And I don't have a crystal ball either. But people come to me with plans, and they say, here's our plan for 2025. And I say, well, maybe I can help you a bit with this plan, but I really know only one thing about it. It's wrong. It's wrong because you can't make a plan for 2025 anymore, not with the knowledge of 2016. You have to make your plans for 2025 with the knowledge of 2023. Because your competitor is going to be doing that. Your competitor is going to start in 2022 and plan their business. You have to be a software business to be flexible. Only the flexibility that being a software business gives you lets you compete in a world that's changing the way our world is. So now, let me get on to the real main attraction here and talk about the marriage of computers and cars, and we're going to get back to that concept in a minute. It's going to be dramatic. There are many pillars of change to our society to be considered. I'm going to start with the one that's actually driving most people, but we're also going to look at other industries like energy, how our cities are shaped, how we get around, where we live, retailing, and many other things. But that most important thing is saving lives, because human beings are not very good drivers. Every year around the world, we are killing 1.2 million people. It's like one of the world's great diseases. It's a scourge upon the earth, and we have become blind to it. So in that country north of the border, about 34 to 35,000 people killed every year, and the American Highway Agency put a cost on that of $870 billion. Now, I worked that out to 29 American cents a mile, which is more than the cost of the gasolina in your Hummer. You're spending more for your share of the accidents you might cause than for the fuel to drive you. And the Americans are also driving every year 50 billion hours doing this. Are you excited yet? To put that in context, the entire productive labor output of the United States is 240 billion hours. That whole country, and 50 billion goes into manipulating steering wheels. So down here, you're not doing too well either. 24,000 people here killed in 4 million accidents on Mexican roads. And by the way, if you're reading ahead, 8% of those involve somebody going the wrong way down the street. So that's something you definitely have to work on. Now, this is a lower number than the United States, but it's four times the mortality rate per car. So this country has a lot to improve as well. 40% of the accidents, the fatalities, involve alcohol, and robots very rarely drink. This famous Mexicano robot is known to drink occasionally. But this is something that you can immediately do better with a machine, along with many other things. So there are immense amounts of our cities given over to cars as well. Los Angeles, it's estimated that more than half the land belongs to cars. 25% of the energy of rich countries is going into driving around. 25% of the greenhouse gases. And I calculated the entire human race. Altogether, we are driving every year 1.7 light years. Do any of you use light years in your work as a unit of human activity? Is that a common thing? It's astonishing to think of it that way. So, this is not something from science fiction. Years ago, people told me they thought they'd never see this in their lifetimes, but that has changed. You're going to have to reset the video. AV team? Hello, AV team? Hello, AV team. Put the mouse over the video and bring it back to the beginning. Remember I told you to reset the videos. All right, go back. Thank you. So about 10 years ago, the US military held a series of contests. And the first contest was a total failure. Nobody got more than 7 kilometers. My friend Anthony entered a motorcycle and forgot to turn it on. But 18 months later, the second contest was a different story. 250 kilometers through the desert of Alta California, empty vehicles completing this course, and this is ancient history. This is Stanford, the team that won. Google hired the people from that team and the people from Carnegie Mellon, who won the next contest, to build a new generation of vehicle. Here you can see Chris Urmson, the leader of the project. He's also Canadian, so he must be smart. Taking the car, driving near Google, on ordinary roads, mixed in with ordinary traffic, stopping at the stoplight, making left turns and yielding. Google has thanked these people for participating in their research, by the way. It does this by seeing in 360 degrees all directions all the time, not seeing the way a human being sees, not driving the way a human being drives. So they've taken it on tough courses, like going through toll booths on the Golden Gate Bridge, the coast of California. This is a street in San Francisco called Lombard Street that all the tourists go to. Difficult challenges like merging onto a busy freeway with trucks and vans. And here's the Stanford team teaching their car to park in a way I don't recommend that you park, by the way. So, since then, everybody has got in the game. Google, I'll be talking about, is one of the leaders, but every car company almost and many other companies are trying to get involved. Here is, for example, Volvo. Volvo has said that in 2017, next year, they will have 100 customers riding in their self-driving cars around the streets of their headquarters town, Göteborg in Sweden, also 100 in London and another 100 in a Chinese city. This is the earliest date from a car company. Most of them are saying dates around 2020. But when Volvo said 2017, of course, well, how many of you know the entrepreneur Elon Musk? You've heard of him? So Elon doesn't like to be second. He has the biggest, well, I don't know what your word here, but in back in the US we say huevos. He has the biggest ones in Silicon Valley, and so he has to be first. So last year, they released a software update on this Tesla car, which gave it a very limited autopilot ability, a self-driving ability. Now, how many of you know what the news is about this car today? Some of you know this, yeah. It's not good news. This is not a self-driving car, and when they sell it to you, they say, you have to always watch it. You have to always be making sure it's doing the right thing, be ready to take over. But it's actually pretty good, and because it's pretty good, some people ignore that advice. Some people drive it and they read their email or do other things and don't pay attention to the road. And it was just announced today that last month a man was riding in this car with the autopilot and he crashed into a truck and was killed. So this is causing shockwaves. Now, as said, he was violating the rules about looking after the car, but this is getting very real. This is no longer something to play around with. So, some of the other companies involved, well, actually one of the leading companies, the German companies, are doing very well. So this is the Daimler or Mercedes car. Mercedes is doing two things that are quite interesting. They're doing a lot of work in their labs, which is very good. But they're also showing a willingness to not act like a car company, which is to say that they have a service in Germany they call Car2Go. I don't know if any of you have encountered that because I don't think they have it here. But Car2Go lets you borrow a small Mercedes car by the minute and one way. You don't have to bring it back where you got it. So they're experimenting with selling cars by the minute instead of selling you a car. For 140 years, they have done nothing but sell you a car. Now they're thinking about something else, and it turns out to be something pretty important. Another company, also German, is BMW. Now, BMW sells sports cars, performance cars, and yet they are also thinking of selling you a self-driving car by the minute with a service that they have. Oh dear, we've got to really improve this. Do we have another clicker? Is there any chance we can scare up another one? No, I don't want manual clicking. So there's another German company which has been doing some very interesting work in their Audi division, but they are going to have a problem saying, trust your lives to our software. Why would we lie to you about our software? This has actually distracted the company and the entire automobile industry and reduced trust in software that Volkswagen had that scandal. And it's too bad because they had a lot of interesting work going on. So, Ford is another company. And in fact, after the Germans, I generally place the Americans, including Tesla. And this is one of Ford's research vehicles. Then we look at the Japanese. This is Nissan's lab, which is in Silicon Valley, very near where I work. And in addition, the Koreans are now just entering the game. This is one of Kia's test vehicles. They just started going, though, late last year, so they have a lot of catching up to do, though they've promised to spend a great deal of money. Now, there are also the companies that make all the parts that go in the cars. And in fact, many of the smarts in the cars you buy today are actually made by these companies rather than the car manufacturers themselves. So you will see projects going on at Continental, at Bosch, at Delphi, Valeo, TRW, and all of these car parts suppliers. And the companies that are not doing anything much are going to actually be depending on these suppliers. This car from Delphi last year drove from California to New York across the United States, and it drove itself about 99% of the time. which they said was an impressive number. But in fact, that's not that impressive, because you really need to drive 99.99999% of the time, and maybe another 9 on there, and that's not 1% harder. That's 10,000 times harder. It doesn't take 10,000 times as long, but it shows how far some of the players have to go. So, let's get the clicker going. People are also working on trucks. Friends of mine have been testing this truck in Nevada, which will change the economics of long-haul shipping, and Mercedes has a project like that. And here is a non-car company, a French company, which has this shuttle, which has been for sale for 2 years. This is not a concept for the future. This is not an idea or a date of 2020. This is a vehicle which doesn't go very fast, and it doesn't go on the highways or anything like that, but it's able to mix safely with pedestrians and other cars and work mostly on campuses. So, well, this is a campus party, so they should have one here, but this has been out, as I said, for 2 years. Now, another company to be very interested in this space is Uber, and this is why. I believe, as many people do, that the real significance here is that the automobile industry is going to shift, a lot of it is going to shift, from being about selling cars to being about selling rides. Now, Uber, in just 6 years, has built the number one brand in the world in selling rides. So this is a huge advantage, and on top of that, they've started an advanced self-driving project, and this is the vehicle that they've been driving around. Now, well, you may not know the other company that's big in this space, which is Lyft. So recently, General Motors put $500 million into Lyft, hoping to also get in the business of selling rides. And on top of that, they put $1 billion to buy a small startup in San Francisco that was just a couple of years old called Cruise. Now, I actually helped Cruise get going, but decided not to join them and didn't get any equity, damn it. But this shows that General Motors is already desperate, spending billions of American dollars. When some people think it's a thing from the future, they're already worried it's too late and that they have to spend billions in order to catch up. Let's see what we can do with a dance. Make this thing work? No? At least it's entertaining. The Chinese are getting into the game as well, and Baidu, the search engine, has said they'll be having trials of their car in 2018. And then this company is also in the game. Now, they're being secretive about it. They don't say what they're doing. But rumors suggest that they're going to have an electric car by 2019 with self-drivability, but they won't say anything else. But I have learned one secret thing about the Apple car. It will only work with the iPhone. So, you know, we all laugh, but I think it might not be a joke. Still. Other non-car projects include this one in Britain, and in fact, the United Kingdom, which may or may not be in the European Union, is the first country in order to change its laws to allow these cars on the road on a national level. So there are 4 pilot projects going on inside Britain in order to make people do these cars. Oh boy, I hate... Are we going to do something about this thing? Is its battery dead? Is the antenna dead? Okay. Now on to Google, as I mentioned. They are the leader. Now, I worked on the Google team for a few years, so I have a bias, but they have now driven their car on real roads for over 2.6 million kilometers. Now, that's more than everybody else put together and times a bit in terms of real self-driving experience. And so they have a lead, which is going to be pretty hard for other people to beat. Not impossible, but definitely difficult for other teams to beat. I'm going to actually show you a video of the first, this is done a couple years ago, but the first non-Google employee to get a chance to ride around in the car.
No hands, no feet. No hands, no feet. there's nothing coming either way. I find myself. Old habits die hard, man. They don't die.
Hey, anybody up for a taco?
Yeah, yeah. What do you want to do today, Steve?
I'm all for tacos.
All right. Well, let's go get a taco at the drive-thru.
If you go to America, I don't recommend Taco Bell.
Places that you cannot go, there are some things that you really cannot do. Where this would change my life is to give me the independence.
So as you see, this gentleman, the head of the local blind center, represents millions of people who do not have the freedom and mobility to get around that we all take for granted. And by the way, I mean all of you when you get older. Because you're going to lose, your parents might already start be losing, or your grandparents losing some of these abilities, but they will not lose the freedom that this provides. Now that was Google's first generation vehicle that looks like a Toyota Prius, because that's what it is. But now we'll take a look at their third generation vehicle.
Helping them with their homework, even just tending to them, finding out how their day was and not having to wait till you get home and have dinner and all that, so it'd be good.
Human feeling of it is very well engineered and it is very smooth. There's nothing that makes you feel the least bit threatened. It's impressive. I'm totally in love with this whole concept.
Well, he doesn't feel threatened, but trust me, the car industry should. As they said, the car is cute and silly and looks like a koala bear. But this is exactly how disruptive technologies that change the world look when they arrive. They do not look threatening to the established players. But if you notice certain things about that vehicle, you'll be surprised. No steering wheel, no brakes, no gas pedal, no dashboard even, because Google feels you probably just want to play your music and watch your videos on your phone or tablet, which is what indeed people want to do. They don't want it in the car. So the numbers behind this are huge. As I said, there's a million people killed in accidents every year. I'm going to show you the potential to remove 200 million tons of CO2 from just one country. And the total ground transportation, car transportation market around the world is $5 trillion. So if you wanted a chance for programmers to save the world, this is it. I'll tell you a little bit about the technology used. On top of the vehicle, you see this. It's called a LiDAR. A LiDAR is a light radar. It sends out pulses of invisible laser light. You time how long they get back, and you get a true 3D picture of the world, not a fake 3D that you have from two eyes, but a real 3D, and we'll take a look at it actually working here. You can see these little lines on the road that are the laser scans, and it's low resolution, but the clouds of dots are cars and trees and rocks and curbs and lines, and you can see all that, and so can the car. It gives us that 99.999999% reliability that we need in order to make this safe. There is also radar on the car. Radar sees further, and radar sees through fog. It also can deal with certain other conditions. It's very low resolution, but combined together, it provides a better picture. My favorite feature of the car, though, are the side view mirrors, wing mirrors that they have on the car. Now, you may have noticed there's no steering wheel and no driver, but the laws in the United States say all cars have to have side view mirrors, and so there they are. So let's step into the future and go back to what I told you about. If you've used Uber, you've actually gotten a lesson about this. You pick up your phone, you say you want to go somewhere, and a vehicle comes to you, and the vehicle may be, if it's just for you, it may just have a desk and a screen for you to work. It may have couches that face each other if you're with your friends. It takes you there on the roads we have today. We don't change the world to match the car. We program the car to deal with the world we have, and this is that lesson I started with from the internet, that stupid network idea. When you put the smarts in the vehicles at the edges and not in the city, you get the pace of innovation that only high-tech can bring, only independent high-tech developers can bring. So a vehicle like that that can run unmanned can do four big things for us. It can drive you around and keep you safer. It can refuel itself or recharge itself. It can deliver a car to you. Cars become a deliverable thing that can just arrive wherever you want them. And it can park or store itself. All of these things together mean big changes for other industries, including, of course, the energy industry, the oil industry. Why is that? Well, today the car industry is driven by one key question in your mind when you go to buy a car. You go to the car dealer and you say, what car do I need for my life? If I ski in the United States or go to the mountains a couple times a year, I buy one of these SUVs. If I travel on my own almost all the time, but I think I might have some friends with me, I buy, like everyone else, something with five seats. And how many people ride in it most of the time? Just one. But you go to the car dealer and you say, I need a car for 5 years at least. So you buy much more car than you actually need. If the question changes from what car do I need for my life to what car do I need today, what car do I need for this trip, suddenly the answer is very different. The vehicle you would never buy as your main car, a small little scooter or lightweight, low-energy vehicle, suddenly it's the perfect choice for a trip across town. In fact, if traffic is very bad, a vehicle that's very small in the width of a motorcycle could be exactly what you want. Well, it turns out these small, light vehicles, when they're electric, are really, really efficient. They're more efficient not just than the other cars. They're more efficient than the buses and the trains, and not just the sucky American trains or the European trains, but then the Japanese trains. That's how efficient transportation can be when it's lightweight, small vehicles tuned to the trip. Now, in addition to this, robots do not care about the convenience of refueling. Or you don't care about what sort of power is inside your taxi. Only the spreadsheet of the fleet manager cares about that. And that's very rational or based on policy. And so suddenly all of the disadvantages of electric cars or other types of fuel are erased, and the advantages of the 100-year lead that gasolina has suddenly are gone as well. So we will switch how we power our cars. If the Americans were to switch to electric vehicles for short trips, they would reduce their CO2 emissions by 200 million tons of CO2, and they would stop importing oil. Have any of you noticed that the Americans have a really annoying habit of going to war over the oil that they import? Isn't that a pesky habit? Isn't it amazing to think that some software might break that habit and have these geopolitical consequences? And here in this country, I mean, look at the air in the DF, right? What there is of it, because I never have enough oxygen whenever I go there. But it's full of pollution, and the chance to move to new types of energy will be wonderful for this country as well. So, what are governments doing aside from going to war? Well, it turns out they're not reacting as you would expect. They're actually jumping up and saying, me, 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 could you please do this here? This is Nevada's first license plate for a self-driving car. Countries around the world are competing. They're saying, maybe the car industry of the future, maybe it's not in Detroit, maybe it's not in Stuttgart, maybe it's not in northern Mexico. Maybe it moves somewhere else. And so you'll see governments changing laws and sponsoring contests and sponsoring projects in Singapore, China, Japan, several European cities, many places around the world, as well as tons of people lobbying to make this technology happen. Now, nothing is perfect. We may find ourselves not walking anywhere anymore, and we've seen how that movie goes. We don't like that story. But let me tell you about a very apropos topic for today, which is the fact that perfection is not attainable here. Perfection is the wrong goal. And so there will be people hurt, as we've learned today. And it's very clear, it's a quirk of humanity, that people do not like being killed by robots. We're just funny that way. We'd rather be killed by drunks, because that's who's killing us now, right? We're somehow used to being killed by other people. We think that's normal, but of course it shouldn't be. But we're very afraid of being harmed by machines. And so when this happens, as it has happened already, you will see public debate, which may go the wrong way. It may go in a rational way, and it will be different in different countries and different court systems. So this is one of the downsides that I worry about. Now, there are two approaches being taken by the companies playing in this space. The car companies are doing what you might expect. It's an evolutionary approach. They're taking cars, which they know well how to build, they're adding computers to them, and they're developing them to make them drive themselves. But the high-tech companies are taking a revolutionary approach. They're taking a computer and sticking wheels on it to see what happens. And as a result, they're doing things without the evolutionary steps, and they want to go directly to the final target. Well, I believe, coming from the high-tech world, that the high-tech approach is better, that the revolutionary approach will win over the evolutionary approach. But this is not certain at all. Now, because of my models, I have a prediction for what the car of the future will look like, and it's a bit different from what you might imagine. I think the most common car of the future is going to be aimed at the most common trip that we have, and that is a trip alone across town, which means it's a small car for one or two people. It's probably electric. It's very simple. It has just a few hundred parts compared to the 20,000 parts in cars today. It doesn't have controls. It doesn't have a dashboard. We make a lot of them because we travel more in cars because we make this cheaper. And we also make many other types. If this is true, then there are winners and losers in the automobile industry of the future. The winners are the people who make and who sell rides rather than the people who sell the cars. The winners are the people who make the components for these new styles of cars, and the losers are the people who make the components for the old big gasoline cars. Now, also on the losing category are the dealers and the insurance companies and the banks who loan them, and the winners are the people who operate the taxi fleets and make the electric cars. So this may be where the automobile industry goes, and of course it's a very important industry in this country, as it is in the United States and many other countries around the world. So, one thing I do believe very firmly is that the most important part of the car of the future, among those few hundred parts, is going to be the computer and the software. Not the engine anymore. Not the leather seats. Not the cup holders. The most important part will be the computer, and the computer lives on our friend Moore's Law. You all know Moore's Law, I hope. Nobody here is stranger to that. In the computer industry, we've lived with that for 50 years, and even we don't understand it fully. But the car is going to change in a way that the industrial world will be completely baffled by. On the right, I'm showing you an ad for an electric car from 100 years ago. That's how fast industrial innovation is. And on the left, I'm showing you an iPhone. 8.5 years ago, Steve Jobs introduced that phone. Anybody in this room not have some kind of smartphone with them? No. And willing to admit it in this crowd? Who didn't have one 4 years ago? Probably just a few of you. That's how quickly high-tech changes take over the world compared to the industrial pace of innovation. And if you don't think phones can be compared to cars, here's a newspaper clipping. It's in English, I apologize, from the American newspaper in 1928, 90 years ago. And it describes the death of the horse and buggy industry and how in just 2 years that industry just was wiped out. The car did this to its own predecessor in just 2 years when the time came. In the 1920s, when the pace of change was faster than today? I don't think so. So trust me, the change is big and it's going to be fast. So, here we go. I should mention as well that these cars will not do what you typically would call parking. If they're a taxi, they just drop you off and pick up somebody else. And if they're yours, they park themselves very densely in the spaces that are not necessarily where they dropped you off. So we're going to see our parking lots emptying out. We're going to see the opportunity to change them into other forms, to turn parking lots, on occasion at least, into parkland. Now, mostly condos, I know that, but nonetheless, there's going to be a big change in real estate, and here is why. In real estate, they make a joke, and they say the most important things for value in real estate are location, location, and location. Well, the meaning of location is going to change. The meaning of distance is going to change, as it did in the 20th century because of the car, as it did in the 19th century because of the tram. This new technology is going to change the value of land and where we live, and so the effects go far beyond the $5 trillion transportation industry I described and into other multi-trillion dollar industries. Now let me tell you as well about a field. This is a project I'm actually working on with a European company. And I want to tell you that around the world, there is one product which seems to be so important and valuable that no matter where you are and no matter when it is, there's a giant infrastructure to make sure that you can get it in 30 minutes. And when we push the button, we'll see what it is. Well, it turns out it's possible, before we build a self-driving car, to build delivery robots, self-driving boxes, suitcases, which don't have to carry passengers, so they don't have the same safety constraints because it's much more difficult to kill a pizza, right? And because of that, we can build this sooner, and that's what we're doing. We're putting delivery robots out that will go at low speeds and low weights onto the sidewalks and bring you anything in 30 minutes, not just a pizza, right? They will be able to do that as well for under a dollar, under 20 pesos. This will change the economics of retailing. This will change even whether you need to own stuff. Because if you can get anything on demand in a very short time for very low money, suddenly you may not need to own these things. So the retail industry and many others are subject to the same level of change. Here is a list, in fact, of a dozen industries that I think will see giant change. And I have talked about some of these, but the automotive industry, of course, and the energy and the real estate. The insurance industry, well, you can guess what happens there. The cars stop crashing. The insurance premiums go down. People start riding in taxis. They no longer get car loans, and that hurts the banks. The doctors no longer are patching you up in the emergency room because of the car accidents. Transit changes. Food changes with the delivery. So many industries change. Even radio changes because there's no drive time anymore because you are not driving. Now, actually, one thing that you might find kind of amusing on here that I added recently was apparel, clothing. And you may say, why that? Well, I did some research and found that over the last 100 years, the clothing industry has shrunk in half in terms of what fraction of people's income they spend on it. And the car industry took that money away. And the reason is that people today use their car to impress their friends. They want to have a Mercedes or a BMW. And in places where they don't do that, like Hong Kong and other wealthy Asian cities which don't have big car environments, they put their money into their clothes instead. So the money that's going into cars, which is going to change, will actually find itself in other industries. So transportation is just inside so many of the industries of the world that the changes will be immense. Well, this is so big that I'm reminded of the original moonshot. We use the term moonshot all the time now. But in the original moonshot, as proposed by the American President John F. Kennedy, the goals were grand. And so I'm going to butcher his words for you. This nation should set itself the goal, before this decade is out, of a computer driving a man to lunch at noon and returning him safely to work. Okay, maybe it's a bad idea to have a Canadian do an impression of Kennedy to a group of Mexicanos. But there is something else in those speeches that I like a lot, something very inspiring. Kennedy said some projects are worth doing not just because they're easy, but because they're hard. And this is one of those projects. Everyone used to think it was science fiction, but it is happening. Brilliant teams are working on it. They are going to succeed, and they are going to change the world. Thank you very much. So now I've left some time for the best part, which is to be interactive. So I would like those of you, do we have some people with microphones who are going to run out so that we can hear the folks? How are we doing that? We do? All right, so let's, young fellow right there in the front, have we got a microphone for him? I see, I throw it to you. Boy, this is fortunately I only have to do this once, and I suck at it, so there you go.
Some week ago, Elon Musk said that in 2 years, the cars will be completely autonomous, and then will take one more year for the legislation. Do you think that's true?
Well, actually, obviously there are problems with getting the governments to figure this out. But there are things, as I said, the governments are being surprising. They're actually saying, please do this here, please write the, they're trying to change their regulations already to make it happen. And it's because they're afraid that the world economy will change and leave them behind if they don't. So there are still much to do with the technology. They're not on the road for sale today. And the biggest problem is actually neither the law nor the technology, but actually just proving to yourself that you've done it, proving that you've made it safe enough. So there are some people who want the regulators to slow it down. If they do, they will cost lives, and I hope that they can believe that. But the truth is, some countries will slow it down, and some countries will go full course on it. China will probably go full course, and when people in the United States and other Western countries look at China and see China leading the world in this, I think they may change their minds about how the regulations will work. All right. Who will we throw the ball to next? Go ahead. Pick somebody. Back there, sure, why not? Better throw, much better throw.
Okay, do you hear me? Thanks a lot, Mr. Templeton. I really admire what you're doing. I have a question, and it always struggles me when we talk about technology, which is the B side, the dark side of technology. All the beautiful things that you told us today, I was thinking about this problem of unemployment, this problem that will happen with drivers. You know, we have seen that in many other industries and throughout the history. You know, and I'm not constrained about the advances of technology. I really enjoy them, but I want to know at your level and the level of the think tanks that you participate, how do you see that problem? How do you care about that problem? How do you handle that problem?
So it's a big issue in many of the fields we talk about, and we talk about this a lot, and we wonder where the world will go and why it might be different this time, because we've actually predicted that machines would take away all the jobs since 1850, and every time we've predicted it, we've been wrong. And so we have to figure out, is there some reason we might be right this time? Now, when it comes to driving, though, I'll have to give you some specific answers. First one, how many of you, when you were young, said, I dream that when I grow up, I'm going to be a taxi driver? Okay, one person back there, apparently. So it's not a job that people seek. It's a job that people take on because it doesn't require a lot of skill, and you can get some moderate money for it. And so I think those people will find other jobs of those types to move into. Now, with truck drivers, it's a little different. Some people do really have a career as a truck driver. But in the United States, the northern United States, not this one, truck drivers kill 4,000 people every year. And the only profession that kills more people is doctors. And the doctors are at least trying to save you. So I'm not sure we would call upon governments to protect a job which is killing 4,000 people a year. You know, that's more than the World Trade Center was destroyed. Everyone is very afraid about that. So other fields there will be the case, but this is one I'm not sure that there will be as much disruption of it. And the truth is, by the way, that people, truck drivers do not like their jobs. They cannot hire enough truck drivers at the wages they pay. They quit after a few years. It's very life draining, takes you away from your family. So of all the jobs that machines could replace, I'm not saying this is great, but these are some of the ones that are less so. And the real other big issue is, remember the million people killed every year by all the driving. I'm not going to slow that down because of jobs. This is being built to save lives, not to destroy jobs. It's true it will destroy jobs, but that's not the reason people are doing it, like some other robots. All right, let's throw the that young woman there. In the blue. Come on, you could have caught it. You could have caught it.
No, I can't. Okay, thank you, Mr. Templeton. My question is, do you see happening soon, do you see happening soon the scenario where autonomous cars are infused with artificial intelligence?
With artificial intelligence?
Yes.
Sorry, did you say infused or confused?
Infused.
Well, the funny thing about the term artificial intelligence is that there's a joke in that field, and they say that as soon as we know how to do it, we no longer consider it artificial intelligence anymore. So we never get AI because, you know, a computer wins the chess championship, and now we say, oh, that was just big, fast hardware. That's not AI. Or a computer wins the Go championship, and now people say, oh, well, now that's just, you know, pattern matching, that's not AI. So the things that are in these cars today are, in fact, more from the field of robotics than they are from the field of AI. However, there is a lot going on today in AI around the pattern matching tools that are known as deep neural networks. And deep neural networks that are trained through convolutional methods, a little bit of calculus, basically, are breaking all the rules about what we can do with recognizing patterns, including looking at images and saying that's a person or that's a dog. And it's going faster than anybody expected. So now people are indeed trying to use this on these vehicles. And in fact, there's one car it's getting so loud. There's one car I rode in where the people are connecting the camera into a neural network and the neural network says, go left, go right. So there's no software in the car at all, or very little. And that's not quite ready yet. But the fact that they could do it at all is interesting. And so, yes, AI techniques are showing up in the vehicles, but not as many as you would think at the beginning. So for now, that's the case. All right, let's throw the ball right to the front.
Hi, Professor Templeton, thank you for the talk. Question will be, I know you belong to part of the faculty of Singularity University.
Yes, I am.
Which efforts institutions such as Singularity University doing to introduce correctly these kinds of technology?
Like I'm not getting all the words, so let's...
Yeah, which kind of efforts is Singularity University and other institutions doing for the introductions of these kind of technologies, like the automation car, to introduce it correctly in society,
yes,
to improve society, and not create like a conflict of our daily lives and...
There's going to be conflict. And yes, we would like to reduce it, but neither would we shy entirely away from the fact that there will be conflict. So the mission of this university, and it's not a real university, and it's not even about the singularity, but it's still a great place. That's one of our jokes. But the mission of this school is to help people understand when technology goes on these exponential curves, when it changes so fast that people can't keep up. How do you deal with that? How do you understand where the world is going? And so we try and bring people in and give them understanding of that principle and all of the new things happening in that technology. And then we charge them with seeing if this new knowledge, which some of them are among the few to have in the world, that they can look for solutions no one saw yet to some of the world's big problems. Problems like food and water and poverty and the environment and health and many others. So this is what we set them to do, and this is our goal to make that happen. We do like to talk to them about the ethics and the political issues. But there is a big, you have hit upon something very frightening and big in many ways, which is pace of change is so fast that half of the world's population feels they're being left behind. They feel that they're being left out. They feel that they are being called inferior. And so they're afraid. And so when a man stands up and says, let's not let any Mexicans into the United States because they're all criminals, or worse, there are people who actually listen to him. And by the way, that man doesn't even believe that, right? He doesn't actually think that that's true of Mexico. He knows if he says it, the people who are afraid of other of foreign people will react and vote for him. This is the reaction that we get when things are going too fast. And we're hoping at least to improve that a little bit, to help people understand how things are going faster. And so, however, people here all told me that you really do want to build the wall to keep the Americans out, and so you might pay for it that way. Okay, next question to throw the ball. We see a few people in the back rows there. So let's have you run back there and we'll get some of them. Let's see how good your long shot is. Not too bad, not too bad.
Hi. So my question is, what's your take on the greater good problem about killing the owner versus killing other people?
I knew it. Yeah. I never can give a talk must. Without it's people ask me, how does the car choose between killing two grandmothers or three babies, or the owner of the car, or Hitler, or Gandhi versus Hitler and Goebbels? So, first question for you is, has this happened to you a lot, where you've had to choose between running someone over and saving yourself?
I kind of run over someone, so yeah.
You did?
Yeah.
So well, get this guy out of here.
Accidentally.
Well, the point is, but this kind of choice where you have two, it's a no-win situation and you have two things that are terrible, it doesn't actually happen very much at all. It's hundreds of billions of miles between that happening. And so people are obsessed about this because it's an interesting problem from a philosophy class, and it's not a real thing that's actually going to happen very often. And the law actually already says you can't go driving on the sidewalk and running people over, right? You've got to stay in your lane, and if you have to choose between someone in your lane and someone on the sidewalk, the law actually says hit the one on your sidewalk even if it's Gandhi, or the one in front of you, even if it's Gandhi and it's Hitler on the sidewalk. So the reality is, programmers don't want to make a decision like this. Car companies don't want to make a decision like this. The law can make that decision. Yay! Well, the law can make that decision, and if we don't like the law, we can change the law. In fact, I think we should let the policymakers worry about it because we have to give them something to do, right? Because otherwise they'll get into all sorts of trouble. So let's let them worry about running over Hitler versus Gandhi, and we can worry about the real problems, like how does the car speed, how does it drive in Ciudad de Mexico where everyone is crazy, right? Those are the real hard problems. Okay, yes. Next question. I know there was another one back there as well, but let's give the guy up on the platform, or did you pay extra to be up there? No? Okay, because if you paid extra, I'm not going to let you ask a question, but... No, throw him the ball. Oh, no, you can ask your question. You can ask the question, then we'll throw him the ball.
Thank you. I want to know your intake on how does this impact the... How does this impact the software security industry? I mean, you are
I'm not getting a lot of your words. Go.
I'm sorry. How does this impact the software security industry?
I mean, big deal. So yeah, we're talking about 1,500 kilogram robots that if you would get into them and break through their security, you could have them run over people, even deliberately run over the grandmothers your friend wants to know about. And this is one of the biggest computer security challenges we have. Because of this, I believe that something a lot of other people think about is not going to happen. There are many people out there who think the cars are going to have a radio network, and they're going to talk to every other car on the road, and they're going to talk to the traffic light, and they're going to talk to the city. But as you know, if you work in computer security, the first rule is the same rule you teach the small children: don't talk to strangers, right? I think these cars will talk only to their headquarters, only over an authenticated, encrypted channel, and if they're smart, they will be suspicious of their headquarters. And they will try and isolate as much as possible those systems. But it's going to be difficult. There's going to be a lot of work, but we're going to do everything possible so that you cannot have an intrusion into the vehicle. Perfection is not possible here, but we would like to reduce the scale of it. Everybody knows this. So today's cars, like the ones they're hacking over there in the other building, they were designed with no security at all, right? The buses have no security, the devices all on the buses, some of them are exposed to the outside world. They didn't think about it at all. Well, I promise you the people building this have learned that lesson, and they think about it, and they red team it, and they're going to try and do as good a job as they can. All right, we're probably near the end of our time. Let's get one. Let's get the ball thrown up to the hoity hot people up there.
Hi. Can you hear me? Okay. It's free. I just walked in and.
I believe you.
I have two questions. One is regarding real estate. What effect do you see? Do you think the cities will sprawl out? And then regarding energy, how do you see the energy future? Are we gonna get away from fossil fuels, get into solar energy? What do you think?
So indeed, I believe we'll get away from fossil fuels. I even think that we will soon see a thing called peak oil. Do you ever hear the term peak oil? But not because we run out of oil, but because we run out of demand for oil, because we're going to move to a lot more electricity and other fuels. We have to. Look at the air, right? Don't tell Pemex this, but this is what's going to happen. Now, the first question was about the real estate. An interesting lesson already happening in San Francisco. Companies like Yahoo, Google, Microsoft, they all run transit systems now, and they have buses. So if you're an employee, you can live far away from Google, get on the bus, and ride for an hour to the office, but you're with your coworkers with the Wi-Fi, so you think you're already at work when you get on the bus, and it goes directly to your company. Well, this has already changed the land values in San Francisco. People actually want to live in the dense, exciting area of San Francisco and commute down to the sprawl area where Google is, and it caused protest marches, and they throw rocks at the buses because you say, you are changing the value of my real estate, you are pushing me out of my own neighborhood. This is just a taste. So some people will live further away and commute for an hour and a half, and some people will live out in the country. Other people will want to live somewhere interesting and exciting. But children will be free to move too. Someday we'll trust our children in this. And today, children do not have mobility, and so you must live where their schools are. In the future, maybe you won't, and maybe that will give more flexibility. So the answer is, nobody knows, because there will be pressures in both directions, so all sorts of things will happen, and nobody predicted how the car would make suburbs and exurbs and all the things we have in our cities today either. But maybe you are the brilliant urban planner who will figure it out. All right, I'm going to ask my hosts, because it's 8 o'clock, do I need to... We should take no more questions. No more questions. I apologize to the man trying to steal the microphone, but it has been great to hear the questions you've had, and you can talk to me afterwards if you'd like for a little while. Thank you again very much.